Tim and Lonnie are in Oklahoma enjoying the weather and the wind and the rain and all the rest of it that goes with the weather this time of year. They'll be back Monday, and so we welcome you to our services today and tell you that if you're gracing us today with being a visitor, we appreciate that, and we want to know who you are so we can send you some information about New Hope Community Church. There's a card in front of you in the pew. Just fill that out, give it to the offering as it's passed in just a minute, and we will send you some information through the mail. You can also use that card to communicate with the church staff or the church office. If there's a need, a prayer request, fill that out and give it in the offering basket as well. A lot of things by way of announcement. First of all, not much is going on around here this week. You could say, well, not much goes on around here all the time, but you know that's not true. There will be no Bible studies this week. What will happen is tomorrow night will be Monday night life group for the high school, and on Thursday night, Celebrate Recovery will meet here in the facilities right to my right. If you bought cinnamon rolls, it was a wonderful fundraiser for a worthy cause. If you bought cinnamon rolls, please pick them up after the service today, right out here in the pavilion. They are here and they are ready for you. Angel Tree, we ran out of angels last week. I think there are more out there today. I know we're going to be given more, so if you were not able to pick up an angel for a gift for the children of an incarcerated person, please stop by the pavilion, and I believe that there are other angels available this morning. They need to be turned in. Those gifts need to be purchased and turned back in by next Sunday, okay, for distribution. So please take note of that. Please bring those by next Sunday. Tomorrow night, what goes on Monday nights? No. Ornament exchange. This is what you've been waiting for all year. And tomorrow night is the ornament exchange, the annual ornament exchange, and that is here at the church. So there's an announcement about that in the bulletin. If you need more information, it's not too late to prepare for that, and we trust that you will come. It's a great time for the ladies here at the church. Christmas banquet. Today and next Sunday are the last days to purchase tickets for our Christmas banquet. That is Friday, December the 6th. It's going to be a classy catering. It's going to be a very, very nice evening. So today and next Sunday are the required times to buy tickets for that. Also, next Sunday is an all-church meeting. It's going to be here in the sanctuary at 5:30 p.m. At that time, we will be presenting to you the 2014 budget, and we will need an approval by your vote for that budget, and so we are requesting that you be with us next Sunday at 5:30 for our budget meeting. 30-hour famine was a great success, and our young people raised enough money to feed and educate 6 children for an entire year. So thank you if you participated in that. If you have sent to the church, specifically it comes back to me, a new members application. I'm about 11 people behind. A month ago, it was Pastor's Appreciation Sunday. Then it was our all-church hoedown, or whatever we called it. And then today, I'm tied up here, so I have not had an opportunity to meet with people. I usually let them come a little early or a little late, and we meet. I'm telling you that so that if you want to come during the week, call, set an appointment, and I'd be happy to meet with you during the week. I believe that is everything that I need to say by way of announcement. This time I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. I understand that we have a group of very lovely ladies who are going to be waiting on us this morning. We should probably, because they're such lovely ladies, collect an extra 10%. So would you bow with me as we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're grateful for who you are and for what you do in our lives. And Heavenly Father, I'm grateful for what you provide for us. You are our source, and we acknowledge that. We thank you for the opportunities that are presented to folks through New Hope Community Church. We're thankful for the opportunity to give back to you a portion of that which you have given to us. And we trust, Lord, that you will make us faithful stewards of these gifts to further your kingdom. We ask it now in Jesus' name. Amen. How about Fresno State Bulldogs? Do you know that Fresno State is mentioned in the Bible? It is. Somebody read the first four words of Philippians 3, verse 2. If you have a Bible, look it up. Philippians 3, verse 2, if you find it, yell it out. Beware of the dogs. So there you have it, a prophecy. Well, as I say, Tim and Lonnie are in Oklahoma. Lonnie has two sisters and many, many friends there. And Lonnie is doing well, for which we are grateful. They're having a good time. They send their regards and their greetings. So they'll be back with us next Sunday. Well, when I found that I was to have the privilege of filling the pulpit this morning, as you might imagine, my first thought would be, because I don't, you know, do this all the time, okay, what am I going to talk about? It could be doctrinally based, you know, it could be a very academic approach, it could be a Bible text, it could be topical. The things that Pastor Tim has been speaking on, like membership and giving and marriage, that's topical. And so there are many, many approaches that could be taken. And all of these possibilities did cross my mind. And as you might expect, along with that, a certain sense of inadequacy took over. One obvious topic, since this is Thanksgiving week, and unless you've been living under a rock, the media of every kind has reminded you that this is the holiday season. Costco loves Jesus more than the other stores because they've had their Christmas, I mean their holiday stuff out for 2 months already. And so since Christmas is right around the corner, is it possible to tie these two celebrations, these two holidays together in one package this morning? And indeed it is possible. The answer is yes. And here's an aside. Here is where scripture memory proves itself to be so vitally important. The book of Matthew tells of an event where Jesus was sending out his 12 disciples to minister to the surrounding area, and Jesus gave them some practical encouragement, and this is what he told them. He said, "Don't worry about what to say or how to say it." Jesus went on to tell them, "At the time you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." Wow, that's cool. So let me ask you a question. Does this still work today? And the answer is absolutely it does. How does it work? It works by committing to memory and placing it up here in your watermelon, words from the book we call the Bible. When I got my car, it's now 10 years old and it's going to last me the rest of my life, it had a little logo on the dash that was a picture of an underinflated tire. And I didn't know what that meant. So I had to stop. I had to get out the owner's manual. And the owner's manual of a car is a little bit more valuable than the owner's manual of a computer, because the owner's manual of a computer is only worth lighting a fire with. There is no practical value to a computer's owner's manual. So I stopped and I opened my book and I looked around and I had to journey through, and all of a sudden I found out what it meant. You see, there are pressure gauges in each wheel, and if one of the tires gets low, the light comes on and it warns me so I can take the necessary steps to avoid either damage to the tire or to the car or to me or to somebody else. And once I took the time to explore the meaning of the light, the next time it happened, I was ready. And that's exactly the way it is with Scripture, the difference being it is the Holy Spirit, when Scripture has been memorized, that aids us and that helps us. And so it was true that this happened to me, and it came across just like John said in his gospel, the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. Now, this is not some kind of miracle. It is the natural work of the Holy Spirit bringing to remembrance what is already there. If I have placed inside my coconut the words of God, the Holy Spirit can then bring that to my memory when it is necessary for me to know how to avoid a situation or a problem or meet a need in my life or the need of another person's life. This serves to illustrate the importance of Scripture memory. And for my case, for our consideration today, the verse that immediately sprang forth once I asked God what His will was for this Sunday, the verse came to mind, 2 Corinthians 9:15. Bear in mind, how can we cover Thanksgiving and Christmas in one sermon? How can I do it according to God's plan and purpose for us this morning? And that verse came to my mind. This is it. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. So there you have it, a text that covers both Thanksgiving and Christmas. But first, we need a little background. Why did the Apostle Paul write this? Let's review. On his third missionary journey, Paul went from Athens to a place called Corinth. Corinth was kind of like the San Francisco of its day, a culture and commercial center, but with a population lacking a moral center. And even the church Paul started was a reflection of the surrounding society. It was characterized by dissension, by disorder, and immorality. And Paul deals with these issues in his first letter to the Corinthian church. That's why we call it 1 Corinthians. Now, by the time Paul wrote his second letter to the Corinthians, which we call 2 Corinthians, false teachers were having a disastrous effect on a church that was already treading water. But through Paul's defense of the faith and his loving encouragement, and by sending Titus to the church to represent Paul and help them along the way, things began to turn around. And they began to turn around to the point where they were not only now maturing in their faith, but they were ready to help meet the physical needs and send offerings to their sister churches up north in a place called Macedonia. And as a result of their rededication to the faith and a hearty ministry of giving to others, Paul was able to observe this and was able to write these words to them. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. This one verse spans for us a true message of thanksgiving and a true message of Christmas. The Corinthians were preparing to send a physical gift, groceries, clothing, whatever else was needed by those up in Macedonia. The Corinthians were preparing to send a physical gift, but Paul relates it to God's spiritual gift. We are being bombarded now with the message of retail. Buy and give, buy and give. Jewelry, clothing, appliances, cars, vacation trips, perfume, cell phones. Oh, not to make and receive calls. Oh, no, no. But to do everything else from turning on your state-of-the-art security system to launching silly-looking birds at each other to make them explode. No wonder they're angry. And here Paul is talking about an indescribable gift. Not one that breaks 3 days after the warranty expires, or one where you need to keep the receipt in case it's the wrong color or the wrong size, or even a gift that will temporarily solve a hunger problem. Paul is talking about the ultimate gift, a gift that Peter describes this way, an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, a crown of glory which will never pass away. Can a gift from Best Buy or Target match that? Absolutely not. And that's why it is necessary to understand God's gift and then to appreciate our proper response to that gift of thankfulness. Romans 6:23, which you know, reminds us that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, you may not like this. This may affront your sensibilities. But in our natural state, you are dead spiritually. You may not like this, but those sweet little babies are dead spiritually. And in the book of Romans, Paul quotes the Psalms in which he tells us what our true condition is without this indescribable gift. Let me read it to you. Paul is quoting the Psalms. Here it is. There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. These verses were true when David wrote them, and they were true when Paul quoted them. And in case you haven't taken note of the sad condition society is in today, they are still true today. But then, a gift was given. An indescribable gift. Paul told the Corinthian church what the gift was, and here it is. when you were dead, when you were, as I just read the quote from the Psalms, when that was you, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive in Christ. He forgave us all our sins. My merit has absolutely nothing to do with me. I can do nothing to achieve this gift, but it has everything to do with Jesus. When you were dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive, not with religion, not by being a member of a particular brand name church, but God made you alive with Christ. And how did he do it? He forgave us all our sins. And so we say, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. But there's a catch. Here it is. The Apostle John said it this way. This is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. But he who does not have the Son does not have life. Insert for our purposes this morning the word gift in the place of the word life. This is the testimony. God has given us his eternal gift. And this gift is in his Son. He who has the Son has my gift. He who does not have the Son of God does not have my gift. You see, the issue is one of possession. My question to you this morning is simply this. Do you have the Son? Have you come to that place where you know to a definite certainty that if you were to die today, you would go to heaven? Let's revisit this passage of Scripture from 1 John. Let's read a verse or two in front of what I already read. It goes this way. Anyone who believes in the Son of God has this testimony in his heart. Anyone who does not believe God has made him out to be a liar. You see, Paul said, if all you have is nature, that's enough. That's enough. If all anyone who has ever walked the face of this earth had was the surroundings around him and they did not respond to it, it says that you are without excuse. It is enough. Anyone who believes in the Son of God has this testimony in his heart. Anyone who does not believe God has made him out to be a liar because he has not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. And then he writes this follow-up. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. Years ago at Fresno Evangelical Free Church, I saw Rick Yon do this illustration. I doubt that it's original with him, but I've never forgotten it. Based upon this passage of Scripture, he said, this pen is the life. The Bible is the Son. The life is in the Son. And he who has the Son has the life. But he who does not have the Son does not have the life. Let's discuss this a little bit. Do you mean that doubt can be done away with? The answer is absolutely yes. I don't know what kind of a background you came from. I don't know if you came from a background that says if you step out of line, you're in trouble and you need to reconfess your sin and ask God to forgive you all over again so that you can be part of His family. Many people come from that kind of a teaching. It has nothing to do with the Word of God. It has everything to do with the religion of men. So I don't know if that characterizes your past or not, but if it does, you need to know today that you can know for an absolute certainty that you have the Son and that you have the life, and consequently you can say thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. The story is told of a very wealthy man who had many valuable art treasures. His only son was quite ordinary, but was dearly loved by his father. When the son died unexpectedly, the father was so deeply grieved that he died a few months later. The father's will stipulated that at his death, all his art treasures were to be publicly auctioned, and that a painting of his son was to be auctioned first. On the day of the auction, the specified painting was displayed and the bidding was opened because neither the boy nor the artists were known. For a long time, no one bid. Finally, a longtime servant of the father and friend of the boy timidly bid $5, everything he had. And when there were no other bids, the painting was given to the servant. At that point, the sale was stopped, and an official read the remainder of the will, which specified that whoever cared enough for his son to buy the painting of him would receive all the rest of the estate. When I receive the incredible gift that God has for me, the gift of His Son, Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches me this: all that belongs to the Father is mine. Listen to these words from Romans. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. I am a co-heir with Jesus Christ of everything that the Father has. The gift is personal. You know the verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that whoever believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. That word whosoever is from two words meaning the one. And so it could be translated this way: for God so loved the world that the one, now it's personal, the one who believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. He loved the world so much that He gave us a life-giving gift of such a personal nature that we couldn't begin to dream such a story or such a gift into being. In fact, the breadth and depth of God's love is so hard to fathom. Here's an illustration. A young father whose wife had just died took his daughter on a cruise to begin the recovery process. As they huddled together on the deck of the ship, the little girl asked her father, "Daddy, does God love us as much as Mommy did?" At first, the man didn't quite know what to say, but he knew he couldn't sidestep the question. And pointing across to the distant horizon, he said, "God's love reaches further than you can see in any direction." The man then looked up to the sky and says, "God's love is higher than the sky as well." And finally, He looked down at the ocean and reflected, "It's deeper than the ocean, too." After hearing his father speak, or her father speak, the girl responded, "Oh, just think, Daddy, we're right here in the middle of all that love." It sometimes takes a child to help us understand the nature of the Father's indescribable gift. The gift is personal. Everyone, whosoever. The gift is also practical. Romans 5, 6 to 8 says, "You see, just at the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners." And here's the gift. Christ died for us. The gift is personal, the gift is practical, and the gift is permanent. Romans 5:1 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand." And a study of the word reveals to us that it is a continuously established condition. When I stand in Christ, there is no one person or one thing that is going to take that away from me. It is personal, it is practical, and it is permanent. And what is my appropriate response for this indescribable gift? The obvious answer is thanks. Why? Because it's biblical. 1 Thessalonians says, "Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." We know the why, but what's the when? Continuously. Psalm 34, David says, "I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips." And the root word for the meaning of the word extol is thanks. When? Continuously, even in distress and trouble. In Psalm 28, David cried out to God for help and mercy, and after doing so, his response was that of praise. Job made this observation in the midst of his troubles. He said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." It is the same word that we just heard, extol, praise. When? Continuously, in distress and in trouble, and also in good times. Psalm 103, "Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits." We think of the holiday we call Thanksgiving as being uniquely American. And indeed it is. And its original proclamation, it fit nicely with the biblical truth we have considered so far. Consider with me, if you will, these words from George Washington in 1789. And I quote, "By the President of the United States of America, a proclamation. Whereas it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey his will, to be grateful for his benefits, and humbly to implore his protection and favor, and whereas," now get this, "both houses of Congress Did you hear that? Both houses of Congress have, by their joint committee, requested me to recommend to the people of the United States a day of public thanksgiving and prayer, to be observed by acknowledging with grateful hearts the many favors of Almighty God. Now, therefore, I do recommend and assign Thursday, the 26th day of November next, to be devoted by the people of these United States to the service of that great and glorious, and here the word is capitalized, being, read God, who is the author of all the good that was, that is, or that will be. So read the very first presidential proclamation. Sadly, America has changed. According to Time magazine, one recent study of 1,000 people found that gratitude led to better psychological health, which then led to better physical health. Grateful people were more likely to engage in healthy activities and seek medical help when needed. Gratitude may make people healthier because it leads to better sleep. Thinking about your blessings before drifting off can help dispel anxious thoughts that lead to restless sleep, a factor linked to physical and mental health. Who knew that Time magazine would make my point? Gratitude also impacts addiction. In 2003, a study involving 2,600 adults, those who were most spiritually thankful had better mental health, including a reduced susceptibility to addiction to alcohol, nicotine, and illegal substances. Many addiction programs have already realized this in practice and often include a gratitude-building component, like making gratitude lists or keeping a diary of things people are thankful for. John Piper, well-known theologian and author, said this: "Thanksgiving with the mouth stirs up thanksgiving in the heart." Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Back in the old days, when I watched television by candlelight, we used to do in church something called a responsive reading. Anybody remember those? They're in the back of our hymnal. They're in the pew in front of you. And I'm not saying that we should do it today. I'm just saying what we used to do. It was part of our norm of worship. I want us to do that today. I want us to close our time together along the thoughts of thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. And I'm going to ask you to stand. And coming up on the screen is going to be Psalm 136. I am going to read a line. And then you as a congregation are going to read the response. And the response is simply this: his love endures forever. I will read a line. You will respond: his love endures forever. Psalm 136. Here we go. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
Love,
give thanks to the Lord of Lords.
Love,
to him who alone does great wonders.
Love,
who by his understanding made the heavens.
Love,
who spread out the earth upon the waters.
Love,
who made the great lights.
Love,
the sun to govern the day.
Love,
the moon and stars to govern the night.
Love,
to him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt.
Love,
and brought Israel out from among them.
Love,
with a mighty hand and outstretched arm.
Love,
to him who divided the Red Sea asunder.
Love,
and brought Israel through the midst of it all. But swept Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. To him who led his people through the desert, who struck down great kings, and killed mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, the king of Bashan, and gave their land as an inheritance, an inheritance to his servant Israel. To the one who remembered us in our low estate and freed us from our enemies, and who gives food to every creature, give thanks to the God of heaven. Gracious Heavenly Father, thanks be to God for your indescribable gift. I pray that those words would ring in our minds and our hearts this season. Regardless of our circumstances, regardless of the good or bad of those circumstances, may those words ring in our hearts this season and forever. Thank you, Lord, for the indescribable gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who turned our lives around, not based on our merits, but based on his merits. He nailed us to the cross. Our sin was nailed to the cross with him. And because of that, we are now spiritually alive if we have responded to that. Thank you for your great love to us. Dismiss us with your blessing, we pray. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.